Hi, my name is Emil. I'm a founder and CEO at Tomorrow Bio, a Germany-based cryopreservation organization. And today we're going to talk about how, after cryoprotection has been done, how the body should be transported. Now, in the past, there were basically two major cryopreservation organizations in the world, ALCO and Cryonics Institute in the US. I know there are smaller ones here and there spread all over the world, but these were the two major ones. Now, for cases in Asia, in Europe, or anywhere basically apart from the continental US, people, after the procedure has been started on site, needed to be transported by plane to the United States. Now, we started Tomorrow Bio and the European Biostasis Foundation in Europe, first of all, to be faster with our SST, with our standby stabilization and transport teams, to be at the patient without delay, and to not need to transport people after the procedure, after the cryoprotection procedure has been done on site, to the US. Of course, now we have, you know, teams here in Germany, we have the long-term storage in Switzerland, and we cover all of Europe. So we can bring one of our teams to, let's say, Spain or Italy or the UK or, you know, wherever in Europe it is needed, and then drive directly after the procedure has been done on site to Switzerland, and then arrive there and then do there the final cool down. Now, in Europe, that time delay is, you know, somewhere between maybe maximum 20 hours, right? From the very bottom of Portugal or Spain to Switzerland, or from the very north, it's max around 20 hours. Now, that is very advantageous. The reason why it's so nice that you can just drive without long delays is that after the cryoprotection has been done, in the past, the long distance transport, let's say from Germany or from Italy or wherever in Europe to the United States, was always done by plane at dry ice temperature. So you do the cryoprotecting procedure on site. Now you cool down the body to dry ice temperature. Now it usually takes a couple of days until you have all the permits, and then you transport the body to the United States. Now the problem for this dry ice transport is that dry ice temperature, which is somewhere between minus 70 to minus 80 degrees Celsius, is the perfect temperature where ice crystals grow. Now, as a quick excursus, ice crystal growth is a two-part procedure, or ice crystal crystallization is a two-part procedure. There's first ice crystal nucleation, which is basically a point where a small ice crystal initially forms, and then around that point, the ice crystal grows. Now, that ice crystal nucleation happens at around negative, you know, a bit lower than negative 180, negative 120, if I'm not mistaken. But this is the main point, so it happens at every temperature, and at negative 80, this is where the ice crystals grow the fastest, around somewhere between negative 70 and negative 80. The fact that you now transport at that temperature, at that perfect temperature for ice crystal growth, of course, is not ideal. In a perfect situation, of course, the whole body should be with high enough, or should be perfused with high enough concentrations of cryoprotective agent, which reduces the probability of ice crystal growth. But, you know, to not take any chances, you don't want to stay longer than absolutely necessary at that minus 80 temperature, or minus 70 to minus 80 temperature. Now, in Europe, we don't have that problem, right? We just drive, let's say, worst case scenario, 20 hours to Switzerland, so we are a relatively short amount of time at that temperature. And of course, usually it's much faster because we're closer to Switzerland. Now, this was the past, but as some of you might know, we're starting to, at least in certain regions of the US, building our own team so that we can cover more people. Starting in Europe was just that, a starting point. Of course, long-term, we want to cover all of the world, but always, once we can honestly say that now we have professional teams close by, or at least some amount of teams close by, who then can, if need be, take a cryopreservation case without much delay and be very fast with the SST and so on. And now that we're starting in the US, we have that problem as well, in quotation marks, right? If one of our teams then preserves someone in the US, we would need to bring them back to Switzerland. And of course, in theory, that would have happened or could have happened in the past as well. Of course, if someone signs up with us, living, let's say, in Germany or somewhere in Europe, and then goes on vacation to Asia, to wherever around the world, and should, for whatever reason, die there, then of course we would pick them up there as well. But just statistically speaking, This is not super likely. Most people don't die during vacation or travel. Most people die, you know, at their wherever they're at home. So it could have happened in the past, but now the likelihood of it happening will go up if we start covering certain regions in the US as well. Now, we thought more and more about how we solve that problem. There's practically two main solutions to it, and we're going to work on both of them, and one is already implemented. One solution is that instead of transporting somewhere between negative 70 to negative 80 degrees Celsius, you transport at cryogenic temperatures. So you cool it down lower than negative 130, 140 degrees, and then you transport at that temperature. At that temperature, you have crossed the glass transition temperature, so the temperature where basically you reach the vitrified state, this glass-like amorphous state, at which temperature no ice crystals can form anymore. Now, doing that is logistically quite difficult. In most cases, these cryogenic temperatures are maintained by using liquid nitrogen, basically a liquid that naturally has a temperature of negative 196 degrees Celsius. Now, the big problem is that in planes, you're not allowed to take liquid nitrogen. The reason for that is that liquid nitrogen, once it warms up, forms nitrogen gas. Now the ratio is that 1 liter of liquid nitrogen forms 700 liters of nitrogen. And of course, nitrogen gas suffocates people. Now, if you have a big, you know, bucket, a big capsule of liquid nitrogen in a plane to keep a whole body, you know, at cryogenic temperatures, and for whatever reason that should tip over, then there would be a tremendous amount of nitrogen that would form, which would then potentially pose a danger to the people in the plane. Now, that is not possible. But what you can do, there are so-called dry shippers, liquid nitrogen dry shippers. What is being done here, the liquid nitrogen is poured into a membrane, like a matrix-like kind of, in quotation marks, foam-like matrix. And in that matrix, the liquid nitrogen is held with capillary pressure in a state where if it would tip over, nothing happens. Nothing, you know, now the liquid nitrogen that is held up in this matrix cannot easily go into gas form. Now, these things exist, right? They're being used, you know, maybe not every day, but regularly for shipping cells and smaller sample tissue samples, something that needs to be shipped at cryogenic temperatures. The problem here is that they exist in relatively small sizes. So come on, like this ballpark. So not large enough for a whole body. So for brain cryopreservation cases, where someone just donates their brain for cryopreservation, in that case, you can use one of these dry shippers. Now, and that's what we're going to do, or that's it's at least one of the solutions. So then you just put the brain at cryogenic temperatures in that cryogenic dry shipper. You ship, the cryogenic temperature can be maintained for more than 10 days, easily enough to have a safe transport by plane across the Atlantic to Switzerland. Now, for brain, that's already a solution. But of course, some people will also wonder, or actually most people sign up for whole body cryopreservation. And we always strongly suggest to do whole body cryopreservation if it's not a money, you know, funding issue. Now, for whole bodies, it is not yet possible to do dry shipping. These dry shippers just don't exist. But we're in the early stages of designing one, a prototype, where we would then be able to scale up the same technology to whole body sizes, where then you would be able to ship whole bodies at cryogenic temperatures. But that might take a while, right? It might be available next year, might take a few more years. So in the meantime, there's another solution to that problem. Now, with certain cryoprotective agents, and including the one that we use, if you increase the concentration of that cryoprotective agent a slight amount, then you reach what is called equilibrium cryopreservation concentration, or equilibrium concentration. And that concentration is so high that no matter what, no ice crystals can form. Just to give you a ballpark idea, in our case, we want to reach somewhere in the ballpark of 65% weight per volume of the cryoprotective agent inside the body. We perfuse slightly higher. We perfuse at 70% weight per volume to reach 65% weight per volume. Now, if you increase that 65% to 70% in the body, so you perfuse in our case then with 80% to reach 70% in the body, in that case, you have reached that equilibrium concentration, which means now you can ship, practically speaking, however long you want, at dry ice temperature without that problem of ice crystal growth occurring. So these are the two main solutions, one of which we can already employ today. The other one, which still is in prototype stage, where some engineering and development is still required to make it happen. But once we launch in the US and accept the first members in the US to sign up with us, one option is already available. The other one is still in development. But nevertheless, there is a solution to be cryopreserved, more precisely, to be cryoprotected in the US. So perfusion, all of that is being done on site, then cooled down to, in one case, negative 80 degrees, or once the technology, this dry shipping technology becomes available, to cryogenic temperatures, then shipped to Switzerland for long-term storage in Europe, in Switzerland, without that, in quotation marks, old problem of you don't want to maintain negative 80 degrees for too long. Now, if you want to think about similar topics, we have a video about future technology. Check it out here. And if you want to sign up for our waitlist for signing up in the US, just reach out to us. And of course, always reach out to us if you have any other questions or just want to discuss the topic a bit more. Just go to tomorrow.bio.